Well, thank you to the American Academy for arranging this and for all of you for coming. It's really exciting to be an academic and be speaking in this environment. As you know, the net poses a bewildering array of privacy challenges, and I'm not going to elaborate. If you've even been reading the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal or any newspaper, you would be aware of some of these challenges, and I imagine that some of you are working directly on them. Now, the dominant approach to protecting privacy online has been an approach called notice and choice. And I've argued elsewhere and also in the paper that this is not an answer to the privacy problem. It's deeply flawed. It's unworkable. It's unfair. But I'm not going to go into the details. I would be happy to. And I also, if you need convincing, I would suggest that I, as many of you, received the notice from Verizon in October, the service notice announcing its foray into targeted advertising. And if you wanted to understand what that meant in terms of the information flows, good luck to you, and please tell me. We called Verizon, and the people on the other side of the phone also didn't know. My proposition, and if there's only one thing that you leave this room remembering in what I've said, is that we need to develop substantive rules. It's not good enough to ask individuals as they're traversing the web to engage in this one-to-one, not even a negotiation, but accepting terms of interaction. We need to develop substantive rules. And these rules, I've suggested, for me anyway, are well guided in content and form by the theory of contextual integrity, which is a theory, it's a theoretical approach to understanding privacy and its value. So I'm going to be very brief and give you a little bit of background in understanding what this means. The first idea behind contextual integrity is to say that protecting privacy adequately is not about individuals controlling or withholding information. It's about assuring appropriate flows of information. And the theory of contextual integrity models appropriate flows in terms of context-specific informational norms, which prescribe the flow of information in terms of the context in which an interaction or the flow is taking place. It could be healthcare, it could be democratic citizenship, it could be education. The actors involved, who it's about, you know, what roles the actors are playing, who it's about, is it a patient, is it a physician, who's sending the information and who is receiving the information, the type of information, your HIV status, for example, whom you voted for in the latest election, and something I call transmission principle, which is the terms under which this information flows. Now, generally, we don't make norms. It's not like laws, which we make, but rather we discover norms. We know what the norms are. People understand how they ought to behave and how they should be sharing information in particular contexts, and that's what we should draw from. Of course, there are a lot of caveats and qualifications, which I'm not going to make now in the interest of time. Norms are not arbitrary. They perform crucial functions in society. Privacy informational norms, which you can think of as privacy norms, protect individual interests. They promote general ethical and political values. For example, the early drafters of the Fair Information Practices start out in their report by saying that these fair information practices level the playing fields among the vastly different actors in the space. And then finally, and what's really important here too, is that these rules of information flow promote context-specific ends, values, and purposes. And so in the healthcare arena, it might be health. It might be equitable access to health. In democratic citizenship, you might have a secret ballot so that you can promote democracy, safety, intellectual growth for education, and so on. Contextual integrity is achieved when norms are respected. Now, taking the ideas of contextual integrity online, we observe And of course, in the early days of the internet, there was this notion that the internet was a separate country. It was today. It's not virgin territory. Rather, it is deeply integrated into existing social structures. It's not all about commerce either. The internet is radically heterogeneous, and that's where we begin. That's where we begin. We recognize the contexts that we live by, the contexts whose norms we are aware of, operate also online, and that should be the starting point for the kinds of substantive rules that I'm suggesting. So we need to formulate substantive rules that are appropriate to the different contexts that we engage in online. The contexts, these rules take consideration of the contexts online, healthcare, democratic citizen, you know, are you going to your senator's website and so on. The roles that you play or others play in the transmission of this information and the type of information is at stake. And in all this, we need to be guided by the past accumulated wisdom, which is how norms evolve in the first place, for example, the secret ballot. Why do we have the secret ballot? I think we can all figure that out. And keeping in mind all that is at stake. We should pay attention not to let technological affordance dictate what the norms are, what the rules are. We should not let ownership of the information determine what the rules are. The idea then is that we develop substantive rules that determine, not fully, we still leave some room for choice in the various interactions. Say if it's if you're dealing with search engines or, oh man.
Technology.
If it's a search engine, if it's a social network, if it's a bank that you're interacting with, we need to have a baseline of substantive rules that are context-specific and speak to the values and the ends and the purposes of specific contexts. Now, this is not going to be an easy exercise. It's going to require various agencies and academics to mull over what those rules are, and no doubt it will be controversial. It'll force us to articulate a lot of the norms and the rules that are only implicit today, and yet they're very robust. We need to confront values and goals. For example, we might start asking questions like, what is the purpose of the healthcare system? Questions we're already asking, but what this theory says is that the privacy rules actually respond to what these goals are. And so even when developing privacy rules, we ask, what are the fundamental purposes of a healthcare system? What is a basic purpose of education, of the commercial realm, and so on? But we shouldn't shy away from this. It's a critical public policy responsibility and opportunity. And I hope that academics, public institutions, and policymakers will not shy away from this. Thank you.